Junkyard 4467, wind 200 at 10, runway 31 left at Kilo Echo, clear for takeoff.
In the early 20th century, RMS Aquitania was conceived by the Cunard Line as the third ship in its three-ship service between Southampton and New York. Three ships were necessary to establish an effective and reliable weekly service between Britain and the city of New York in the United States. Aquitania's two running mates would be the already constructed Mauritania and Lusitania. These ships are commonly mistaken as Aquitania's sister ships. In reality, Aquitania would be much more similar to the Olympic class of ships of the White Star Line than her two running mates, in that she was bigger and designed with an emphasis on passenger comfort over speed. The result was that Aquitania would be 50% larger than her two running mates. Aquitania would have a service speed of approximately 23 knots, compared to Lusitania's service speed of 25 knots with a maximum of nearly 27 knots. And the more comfortable accommodations would make the longer crossings less of a burden for her passengers. Ultimately, Aquitania was the necessary third ship in a trio, but more importantly, she was Cunard's answer to the Olympic-class ships of the White Star Line. Throughout the era of the ocean liner, and particularly in the early 20th century, shipbuilding was the frontier of technological development, and ships were symbolic spectacles to the public. Aquitania would be the second largest ship in the world, right after Hamburg America's SS Imperator, and her launch in April 1913 drew a crowd of over 100,000 people. The ship spent the next 13 months being fitted out with boilers, funnels, and furnishings, before starting on her maiden voyage in May 1914 under the command of Captain William Turner, who would later find himself in command of Lusitania at the time of her sinking by German U-boat U-20. Aquitania's maiden voyage, though, was overshadowed by the sinking of Empress of Ireland, a tragedy which resulted in the death of more than 1,000 people the day before Aquitania's arrival in New York on May 30th, 1914. She would sail only two more commercial voyages before World War I broke out, and she was requisitioned by the British government and pressed into service as an armed merchant cruiser. Initially, she was assigned to the role of patrolling the Western Approaches, the area of water immediately west of the western shores of the British Isles. Not long after entering service with the Royal Navy, Aquitania collided with the Leyland Line's ship Canadian. As a result, it was determined that Aquitania was too large and thus unfit to serve as an armed merchant cruiser. This realization was part of a recurring theme. The British government had provided financial incentives to Cunard so that Lusitania and Mauritania would be designed to meet certain specifications so that they could be used as armed merchant cruisers, which proved to be impracticable. After all three ships were conceived as passenger-carrying ocean liners, not ships of war. The Navy would have to find another use for Aquitania. She was brought to Liverpool for repairs in June 1915, and she was reassigned to the role of a troop ship. This role would prove to be a much better fit for Aquitania. On June 25, 1915, Aquitania left Liverpool carrying 5,000 troops bound for Gallipoli in present-day Turkey. After three successful voyages as a troop ship, Aquitania was converted into a hospital ship and served in this capacity for a brief period during December 1915 and January 1916. She was then delivered to Harland and Wolff to be converted back into her civilian state, only to be brought back into service with the Royal Navy. She served once more as a hospital ship in November 1916. Then, when the United States entered the war, Aquitania was tasked with transporting American troops to continental Europe. World War I ended at the close of 1918, and Aquitania needed extensive refitting before she would be ready to return to the Atlantic run for Cunard in commercial service. Between November 1919 and June 1920, the ship underwent renovations and was converted from a coal-burning ship into an oil-burning ship. She was placed on the Southampton to Cherbourg to New York route with her running mates Mauritania and Berengaria, which had replaced Lusitania after her sinking. Throughout the 1920s and 30s, Aquitania was in the prime of her life, carrying passengers across the Atlantic. She was affectionately called the Ship Beautiful, and she was a major and popular liner among the public and was instantly recognizable to many. Beginning in 1932, Aquitania began spending part of her time as a cruise ship. I plan to have a video in the future on the differences between ocean liners and cruise ships, but for now, all you need to know is that cruise ships typically take passengers on pleasure voyages, while ocean liners serve primarily to transport passengers from point A to point B. Aquitania's first cruise left from New York, bound for the pleasant Mediterranean Sea, and she would also cruise to Bermuda, leaving from New York. At the end of 1932, the ship underwent another extensive period of renovation, which modified the passenger configuration, generally reducing the ship's passenger capacity in favor of passenger comfort in all classes. In the end, her passenger capacity would be 2,200, a 31% decrease from the ship's original 3,200 passenger capacity. This modification was logical given that the ship was spending part of her time as a pleasure vessel, whose passengers would have required more luxurious and spacious accommodations. Beyond renovating all the public rooms on the ship, room was made for a theater to entertain passengers while on board. Cunard had planned for Aquitania to be retired in 1914, only 8 years later, but her life was extended by the outbreak of World War II. The Royal Navy once again requisitioned Aquitania in November 1913 for service again as a troop ship. In 1940, she was fitted with 6-inch guns for self-defense. Based in Sydney, she was used to transport Australians and New Zealanders before being repositioned to the Atlantic. In March and April of 1942, she transported U.S. troops from the mainland to Hawaii, and then moved to the Atlantic again to transport Americans to Britain. In the first half of 1944, the Allies relied heavily on Aquitania and other large, fast troop transport ships in the months leading up to the invasion of mainland Europe. Without civilian troop ships, the rapid and urgent buildup of troops may not have been possible, and the feasibility of the invasion may have been impacted. At the end of World War II, Aquitania assisted in the repatriation of American and Canadian troops before returning to Cunard once more. During 1948 and 1949, Aquitania was chartered by the British government to serve on the Southampton to Halifax route across the Atlantic. But by the end of the 1940s, Aquitania was becoming too old to continue commercial service, and in 1949, Aquitania's Board of Trade certificate was not renewed. There was an infamous incident which occurred around the end of the decade in which a piano fell through a corroded deck in one of the dining rooms due to the corrosion that the ship had been seeing. And in January 1950, Aquitania was sold to British Iron and Steel Corporation for 125,000 British pounds and was subsequently broken up in Scotland. Aquitania was a unique and notable ship. She was the second longest serving Cunard liner until that record was broken in 2004 by the iconic Queen Elizabeth II. Aquitania was the only major ocean liner to serve in both world wars and, ever popular among passengers, generated a consistent profit for Cunard even during the Great Depression. She was the last survivor of an exclusive and small club of four-funneled ships. And by the end of her career, she had carried 1.2 million passengers, including 400,000 soldiers, and sailed 3 million miles over the course of 450 civilian and military voyages. Today, one of Aquitania's wheels is kept at the Maritime Museum of the Atlantic in Halifax, Nova Scotia, which I can say is an excellent museum, and if you're ever in that area, I definitely recommend going. On a personal note, I used to dismiss Aquitania as an afterthought, and I never understood why so many considered her to be such a beautiful ship. I think it was the height of her superstructure relative to that of her hull, and it always threw me off. But after learning more about her career and getting used to her appearance, I can say that the late Aquitania is growing on me.